So I think we'll just start just by talking just sort of generally about the collaborative film process in making films. And you know, when you're conceiving a project, when it's the sort of early days, how does that happen? Particularly, I think I'll start maybe with you, Jeremy. And you know, when projects are starting to arise, what's the conversation that happens between producer and director?
The first conversation I had with David Cronenberg, I'd had a couple of red stripes in a bar in Toronto. I was here with a film called Bad Timing, which had been awarded Labatt's Award for most popular film, and I was at a party and I met David, and I told him how much I liked his films and what did he want to do. I said, I'd like to make a film of Naked Lunch. And there was an explosion of lightning in my brain. And I thought, well, there's only one person, this is an unfilmable book, but there's only one person I know whose films I've seen who could possibly ever go at it, was David. So that was instant bond. And we took some time for David to sort of write the screenplay, but I kept faith in the optioning the book, and the Naked Lunch came into being a few years later, and was the first of, a sort of river of life experience. Unforced, but sort of jointly liking various subjects to make it really based on the taste, I suppose, and that's how it started.
Fascinating. David, do you have anything on the producer relationship?
Yeah, well, what happens next is a script, and in terms of the actual making of the movie, I mean, there's all kinds of collaboration that goes on that has to do with the financing of the film, and I won't bore you with that, but it does actually, it takes a lot of our time, doesn't it?
It's not, actually, I think it would be very useful for our crowd here to understand the basic mechanics of that.
Often I'm asked to go to the Cannes Film Festival, not because I have a film there, but to kind of schmooze with various distributors who might be interested in doing a pre-buy of a project, you know, and I'm there to convince them that the film that we're going to make, let's say Naked Lunch, is something viable and that they should buy it for Finland, you know? I mean, should see Naked Lunch.
We call that a dog and pony show in the trade.
It is a dog and pony show, and I'm not sure who's the dog and who's the pony. We switch. Sometimes we switch around. But sometimes the pony is riding on the dog, actually. And that becomes a hugely important part of getting the film off the ground, and I can tell you that it took me 10 years to make Dead Ringers. It took me 8 years to make the last movie I just made, Maps to the Stars. That's the first one was 1988, got made, and the last one was just this year. Things haven't changed. If you're making independent films that are difficult, that are not immediately obviously commercial, there's a lot that goes on into, you know, even before you write the script. Sometimes there is a script, let's say that Jeremy has, you know, financed my writing of a script, and then we can go to do this dog and pony show with the script. But it takes quite a while before you get to any point where you're actually in production, because I've actually had an instance of a so-called a woman whose name I won't mention. It's because I've forgotten it actually. But there's certain good things about aging. And you forget things that you should forget. It's good. Was in finance and decided to become a producer. And when we started to talk about deposits of money so that we could get into pre-production, she said, "Well, you're not shooting the film in pre-production, right?" I said, "No, you're preparing it." She said, "So what do you need money for?" And I immediately said, "Okay, we're not making a movie together," because that's where so much is done, and that's where the collaborating with your you know, the actual people who are making the movie aside from your producers, that's where that happens. But it's quite a struggle to actually get to that point.
In fact, to use Naked Lunch as an example, because this involves Stephan as well, that was very difficult for me to do, because normally with a film, you get the cash to start making the film in a correct way, building sets and building other things 8-10 weeks before the film starts. in the film, not Lincoln Lunch, because we had to have these special effects and the creatures and the various other areas which needed research and needed sort of building and trying and a lot more preparation time, which nearly, I think, 6 months or 9 months we needed. So you have to find the resources to start making the film a long, long time before the film is made. So that adds a certain sort of difficulty, an additional difficulty to making a film which involves special effects.
It's a great segue, actually, for you, Stephan. When do you normally enter into the sort of cycle of production? How does that sort of gestate, and how do those conversations begin with the filmmakers?
Well, it really depends. It's depending on the film, like a film like The Naked Lunch, for instance, that was several months of pre-production because of all the elaborate stuff that's in it, mugwumps and typewriters and transformations and God knows what. So, yeah, absolutely. That was several months in pre-production before anything. And then even before that, when I got the script, of course, my first reaction was kind of like, you know, this. It's because of all the stuff that had to be done and very unusual stuff. And then it was basically communication with David with drawings, you know, a lot of sketching, drawings, discussion on the phone and emailing and so on and so forth. And then from there on, there's maquettes being done, three-dimensional maquettes fairly often. And from there, the decision is made to go ahead. And even when the actual object is being sculpted, there's always a flow of photographs usually going in. For instance, the mugwump was from David's idea, let's kind of make it look like Burroughs. The facial structure, kind of like a mugwump version of him. And of course, his voice was like, so it was perfect, you know.
That's great. And so, and is the director, in either David's case or others, are they giving you a kind of a vision at the beginning other than the script before you start in the drawing process?
Usually it really depends. It's for instance, like Existence, we were talking about these little pods that everybody has. And so we went through several versions to the point where they were, at first, I remember, they were kind of like gross looking. It's kind of like a brain and so on. And talking with David, I said, I don't think I would like to have this in my lap or fondling this thing. And so we went from, it's still organic. It's still a little animal, but it was...
It was curvaceous and sensual.
Yeah.
Quite nice, actually.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Interesting.
But it does take a while. I mean, it begins with the script, but for example, and I'll mention Existence as another effects-heavy movie that we did together, the bone gun in that is described in quite a bit of detail in the script, but it's never enough to actually show you what it really looks like. I mean, there's still a lot of work, and there are so many variables and so many possibilities. So the script, even a detailed one in terms of, let's say, effects, or production design, or even, you know, the restaurant in Eastern Promises, which was a very elaborate build for a production designer, it begins with the tone, but then you have little epiphanies, you know, little moments that clarify which way to go. Sometimes it's because you see something that's the wrong direction, you know. I'll just mention the telepod in The Fly. The first versions of it were the obvious things because it's a thing that you get into and you close the door. So it's like a shower stall, right? Or it's like a phone booth. But then, no, that's really boring. And so at that point, Carol Spear, who's done most of my movies as production designer, I said, Carol, come out to my garage, because in there is an Italian motorcycle with a cylinder head that's got fins and it's just beautifully made and cast aluminum and so on. This is now in the exhibit. I still haven't gotten it back into my motorcycle. The telepod should look very machine-like and machiney, and it should look like this. And literally, she like almost single-handedly pulled this motor out of the bike and took it away, and I didn't see it for like another 2 years, and used that inverted to be the design, now 9 feet high instead of a small motor. And so it's a little epiphany, as was the mugwump. It's like, the mugwump is William Burroughs. This creature should look somehow, his chest, his posture, his something about his face, and his voice. It should look like Burroughs. And as soon as we come to that, that inspiration can come from anywhere. It could come from me. It could come from you never know who. And for me, it doesn't matter who, as long as if it's the right one, it's the right one. And that's part of the collaboration. I think it should be said right off the top. There are directors who, if they can't either pretend that the idea came from them, or it actually did come from them, then they will not accept it. It's an ego thing.
I mean, I think having worked with lots of directors, the great director takes ideas from everybody, and then everybody accepts, and they accept it. He makes it his own because he has to. It's sort of there's a sort of transference of, because that's the whole point of collaborating on films, is that it takes many, but there's one person who makes a decision. And therefore, that everybody presents up ideas in every area of the film that you're collaborating on, working together. But then they become the director's ideas.
I have to say, you know, I get interesting feedback on the set. For example, Robert Pattinson, who was in Cosmopolis and was the lead actor who was in every scene, and at a certain point he said, you know, I've never seen this before. I said, what do you mean? He said, well, you make all the decisions. I mean, if you decide to change something, we just change it right there on the spot. And I said, yeah, it's just us. There's nobody else. We're making the movie. He said, none of the movies I've done up to this point is like that. There's always a committee. There's a studio, notes, memos, screenings. Before you can change the color of a sweater, it takes 2 weeks to get the okay from, you know. So in an independent filmmaking, the good part of it is that you don't have that committee problem. The bad part is that the financing is always a struggle.
And on that note, why don't we were just talking about Naked Lunch. We have a great clip, so I think we'll just run that clip and come back to how that film was made. Fantastic.
So the mugwump is my version of E.T.
It types home somehow. Jeremy, so you mentioned that you were talking to David about Naked Lunch, this famously unfilmable novel. How did you go about preparing to talk to the world about this? And what further conversations after this sort of moment over the beers did you have to have in order for you to be able to do your job?
No, it was a different time, a different era of executives. And there was some respect for William Burroughs and respect for this novel, although nobody had read it, luckily. And David and somehow the whole project took a momentum on after these many years of talking about it. Suddenly there was a screenplay and these various drawings. I managed to get enough people to support it. It was very, very difficult. I can't say it wasn't. It was one of the most difficult films I've ever had to put together because it was a film, as you can see, it's very, very unusual. And it's metaphorically talking a lot about drugs. And we were promoting it as a film about writing, as a writing class for people.
Did people believe that?
I managed to persuade enough people that it was sort of like an adventure story about writing.
You mean it wasn't about that? I really thought it was.
Because there was this... David managed even to get this Bombardier Jeep. There's a Jeep at the end of the film. I don't know if those who've seen it. And the film had all the things that I liked in it as well in terms of props. And it was shot in Tangier. Anyway, we managed to find a way of doing it. And on the journey to make this film, David and I had one of my great experiences, which was a dinner with William Burroughs and Paul Bowles in Tangier, which eventuated when we were there looking for locations for a film set in Tangier, which we couldn't ever film in Tangier because it was because of the Gulf War, which was one of the very strange elements, which I believe, in fact, gave this film some very, very special qualities, the fact that it was forced, that the interzone was forced back into Toronto.
Yeah, actually, you remember we were watching the war start on television. And you were thinking, what were you both thinking? We're screwed because there's no way that you could get insurance to fly to Tangier at that point because there were warplanes and warships everywhere. And it was game over. And I said, well, why don't, let's just do it in Toronto. well, Interzone was a mythical place anyway. It wasn't exactly Tangier. And in the movie, we do blend the two.
And you said, I can get camels in Tangier. I mean, in Toronto, they got some camels in the zoo. I'm sure we can duplicate it on the main street. I think I shot it on Spadina, I think, with a couple of camels.
So, note to budding filmmakers, there are camels in Toronto. It's fine. At that point, so you're having this, I mean, I'd love to have been a fly at wall on that dinner. At that stage, when you've sort of written your draft of the script, when you're beginning these dog and pony shows, how much change occurs to the film, David? You know, up to the point, because when Stephan comes on, when pre-production begins, things are quite set. But up to that point, when you are sort of having conversations with, you know, in this case, the novelist or other creative people, or even, you know, potential financiers, do things change?
They don't change because of the financiers. They, in fact, nothing is set. It's an illusion to think that anything's set. It's not set. I mean, you have the script, and perhaps everybody sort of signs off on the script. But even that, you know, when I'm editing and I decide to cut a line out of the script because I feel that it doesn't work, I'm not going to anybody for that, you know. But you assume that these things will, it's very organic how it works, with me anyway. I don't do storyboards. I've never done storyboards. One or two special effects sequences had required that in The Fly, maybe once. It's all up for grabs for me. I don't know what I'm gonna do when I go on the set. I mean, and it's the same in prep. We're gradually evolving and developing things and letting it happen organically. And there's a lot of interaction, of course, amongst the collaborators. For example, Stephan and let's say Carol Spear, if she's the production designer, and Peter Susitsky, the director of photography, he can influence the design of a set because he can say, but, you know, I really would like to have a place where some light can come through a skylight or something, so we add a skylight. And this is, so there's nothing set. And that's actually what I like. I mean, I remember Fellini famously said, if I knew what I was going to do every day when I came to the set, I'd be bored. You know, I where are the surprises? Where are the, you know, the delights and so on? And I feel the same way. So it's a very organic process, the preparation. And then once you start shooting, everything is constantly shifting as well. A lot of, for me, filmmaking is found art. The thing is that the things that have been put there by people like Stephan. It's not like, and yet there, if you're shooting on the streets, sometimes it really is found art. You know, things that you, people you find, or backdrops, or weather, or cars, or, you know. So it's for a director, it's a weird combination of being a total control freak and absolutely the opposite of that. And actually hoping for surprises that you can't control. And another quote, Orson Welles says, a director is someone who presides over a series of accidents. You know, so the idea that Hitchcock promulgated, which was total control, I do it all myself, I create it on paper alone in a room, and then I just execute it, not even for him, not true.
Right. You know,
impossible.
Mythology.
Reality will not let you do that.
Stephan, this is what I didn't realize that there was so little advanced storyboarding, even for some of the most complicated movies. I mean, you've worked on sets which I think are precisely the opposite. I have to imagine that every single second of 300 was, you know, drawn out, for example.
Yeah, 300, that's a completely different animal. That's definitely was storyboarded from A to Z, like a comic book.
Which do you prefer?
It comes from a comic book.
Which do you prefer? Do you like the sort of fluid, you know, I wouldn't say chaos?
It's nice to have some storyboards, of course, like The Fly, because there's a lot of things involved, like the puppets and so on, where they can walk, where are the puppeteers going to be? That's where Carol Spear comes in. You know, the sets have to be built so to hide all those people, the cables, so on and so forth. But it's nice to have a little bit of that creative leeway. Well, we can put it over there, or we can do this, we can do that. So it's not everything is set in stone. You know, it has to look exactly like that drawing. because it would be like, well, why don't we just do an animated film, the storyboard while we're at it, you know?
Yeah, for me, for example, the probably the only truly storyboarded sequence ever for me was the end of The Fly, and part of it was the effects people really wanted to make sure that they weren't going to be asked to do something that they could not do. They said, you know, we can't give you a full figure of the fly that we can animate. So they wanted to make sure that I was not going to ask for that, you know, and then they could show me the storyboard and say, but it's not on the storyboard. And I think it was really more their comfort than, you know.
Yeah, absolutely, because, you know, that was the age of pre-CG. Everything was done on set, yeah. You know, the puppets, the creatures, and everything was like real. The actors could react to something that's real. And I think we're going back to that right now in films. They want to see more real stuff. We've been like deluged with CG imagery, and I think people are getting tired of it because it's obvious.
Yeah, I mean, I think the Mugwump definitely would have been a CG creature now. But he had such presence in that room, and when he, you know, his tongue came out, and when he spoke, the lip movements and everything, that's all physical. You know, there was no CG.
That's because he was actually there.
You treat it like a real person. Yeah.
He was an actor.
He was an actor.
A great actor, because he wasn't very demanding.
He didn't eat very much either. It was good for
the 80 people under the floor who were operating him. It was a little demanding in terms for them.
Yeah, do you want to talk about that a little bit? What does it take to create this? I mean, from beginning to end. So
insanity is good. It's a good start. Well, a lot of people involved, because the texture of the skin, how it's made, what it's made of, how flexible it is. I mean, Stephan could tell you more about that.
It has to be sculpted like from, you know, head to toes, like grandeur nature, as we say. And then you have to take in consideration all the moving parts. Like, you know, one thing that I like that we added is you can see the cheeks puffing, like opening up and so on. There were bladders in there to make it move. The mechanical department, what I call the fluid of life department, hated my guts because I designed the Mugwump, so it was very skinny. And usually they like to deal with creatures or animals that are really fat, so they can put as many cables and as many servos as they can in there, and they have room. Well, not this guy. You know, I mean, he was really skinny, so you had to do like all this miniature cables and so on and pulleys and stuff, but that was the character and it looked great because of that.
If we had made it look like the writer Umberto Eco, you would have had more room.
Oh, plenty.
That's great. Shall we take a look at this? We have a clip of from Crash, which is a very different film, obviously the creatures of a different kind, but still taking actor in human form. We'll talk about how that film came together. Please roll our Crash clip. Crash. So, Jeremy, another extremely difficult novel, another complicated production. How did you and David begin talking about it? How did the production come about?
Well, it was I can't remember, as opposed to Naked Lunch, I can remember exactly when and where. But sometime in a meal or a cafe or an off moment, we were discussing making another film because it was very enjoyable making the collaboration we had on Naked Lunch was really enjoyable. And David threw out Crash as a novel that he fancied as a movie. And like Naked Lunch, it is something that I'd read and had sort of affected me a lot when I read it. And again, well, David, you know, he's again one of the only directors, if the only director who could approach it in the way that I think it could be approached, because it would have a sort of an originality and a take on it, and within the law that could be showable. And I'm really pleased with what David, just seeing that film now. I mean, it was I got to compliment you again. It was an amazing film, and it was. We had no idea, David can speak for himself, but I had no idea that the film was going to become as controversial, especially in the UK, as it became. It became sort of a very big trouble spot for those involved for some point, and was banned and still is unable to be shown in London, which is extraordinary in central London.
Still to this day.
To this day. And it's an incredible tale, and written by one of the greatest writers ever, the great late J.G. Ballard. And the film, again, was very difficult to raise the money for obvious reasons, like Naked Lunch. And it's not a mystery that these films are difficult to raise money for, because they are very unusual to adapt these books for a screen adaptation, which they're perfect for it. And so that was a lucky break to get that. And I think it's one of my favorite films that I've been involved with.
Well, I have to say, for a director, you know, finding the right producer for your particular film is, you know, and that's usually the first collaboration, unless you've worked with a writer to prepare the script before that, which is for me not normal. Finding the right producer is a crucial moment.
How do you know you're onto the right person?
Well, first of all, they have to be excited about it the way that you are. I mean, Maps to the Stars, there were quite a few producers I went to, and they were shocked at the script of that, and they were Hollywood. And I actually had one very well-known Hollywood producer, but he's a Hollywood producer who does do independent films, and he said, I could never do that to this business, which has been so good to me. He actually said that, because the movie, the script, was, you might say, somewhat critical of Hollywood. Although I don't really, that's not the main appeal that it had for me. So that guy was obviously not the right guy.
That's very funny. I'm watching this, you know, these wonderful actors that you were able to assemble for this film. When does the casting process occur, and how much of that is that a conversation also with the producers when you're making films? Because you know, obviously, so much of financing is to do with actors still, you know, even for independent movies. So what is that conversation like?
Casting is a really complex thing. You would think it'd be simple. It's far from simple. There's so many balls being juggled before you can find the right actor. Deirdre Bowen has done most of my casting, and as Jeremy will tell you, she's almost like an associate producer herself. She's incredible. She doesn't sort of, she doesn't say, this is who will be in the movie, but she finds you people, and she connects with them in such a way that makes the film very attractive for them. A crucial collaborator and very invisible compared with what Stefan does, because it's obvious on the screen, his work. But for a casting person, it's kind of invisible, but incredibly important. For example, Dead Ringers, I went to 30 actors, 30 of the best-known actors in the world. You know, I'm talking about Pacino, De Niro, William Hurt, Kevin Kline. They all said, are you kidding me? We're not doing this. And Jeremy Irons, we had to find Jeremy Irons. He was the first viable actor who said, yes, I'm interested in it. He didn't say, I love it, I'm desperate to do it. He said, well, I'm interested. I almost burst into tears just because an actor said he was interested, you know? Because unless you have a star of some magnitude, who you consider a star is totally variable. There's no rule book really for it, but it has to be, you know, your producer has to feel that that he has a viable cast to sell the movie, that people will want to come and see it, quite independent of the script. When you say, I've got this person and that person and that person, and they say, wow, that's a great cast, you know, that's what you want to hear. And it's very hard to make a movie with unknowns. I mean, really, so difficult if the movie has any kind of budget at all. Even though you might have great unknowns who then become stars, and certainly that does happen. But you have to accept the budgetary limitations of that, which for a director means not just you don't get paid a lot. It means that you might not have the means to make a really well-crafted professional film. Which is that's always a problem. So the casting is, as I say, is a really tricky thing, because you have to get the right person. But, you know, it's even simpler than that on some levels. You have to get, they have to be the right age. You know, they have to be the right nationality, or at least be able to fake the nationality. It begins with the basic stuff, but then it gets weird, you know, because you find, for example, at a studio, you find, you know, I was trying to cast a movie, and I wanted Rupert Everett, and I met with him, and the studio guys. This was at MGM.
Is this for Dead Ringers?
Or? No, it's not. It was for, I hate to say it, it was for Basic Instinct 2, which I was tempted to do, because actually the script was really quite good, and it was written by Henry Bean and Leora Barish and people I knew, and it was actually a good script. The movie's terrible, but I felt I could make a good movie out of it. And the guy at MGM said, Rupert Everett is gay. He can't be in this movie. I said, are you kidding me? He said, yeah. Because he's playing a straight guy. I said, well, I can't believe you're saying that in this day and age. He said, no. I mean, it's not, I mean, there are a lot of actors who are gay, but they don't let anybody know, you know. And he's been very militant about his gayness. And on that means, and because he's playing a sexy guy with Sharon Stone, it's not going to work. And I was really shocked.
Because actors can't act somehow.
Well, it's as though there's a certain, you know, Viggo Mortensen, who's American-Danish, can play a Russian, but Rupert Everett, who's gay, can't play straight, you know? And I think, that's a hit, you know? But there it was. That was the reality. And it was an MGM project, and there was no way around it. So that's the kind of weirdness you run into.
Jeremy, talk about because it must be a very difficult dance for you as a producer, because there probably are actors who aren't going to get it made, and you have a director who maybe latches onto someone or back and forth. How do you navigate that?
Well, with David's been making films a long time, like I have, and most of David's collaborators have. So there's this, I mean, we're talking about it before in the green room, there's a sort of unsaid world around movies that happens because it's something that you're experienced in. And so we don't even have the conversation. You can't have unknowns. I mean, you just, you know, if you've got an actor, say, who's, yeah, if you've got somebody who's 22, you can have unknowns because there aren't any famous ones. If you have actors in their 30s or 40s, by the time they've reached 30 and 40, they're normally quite well known if they're good, normally. So that's sort of an unsaid thing, that we're looking for actors who are attractive for our project, not only because they're very good actors and very attractive for the part, but because they're well known and will help our film to be seen by other people. So there's something which is a desire automatic desire, unless you're sort of a bit silly. It's your desire. I want decent actors who are well known in my film because it's going to help people see my film, and nobody wants to make a film that nobody sees. So that's, you know, it's a square one. So that hump, and then you try and find actors that which are right for the role, which will serve the purpose to make people understand, oh, well, that person will be good in that role. And it's sort of an organic process that happens with lists of people, and some people are immediately chosen. They're the person we want, and then other times other actors come to it for various reasons, and then they always become the right actor once they're in the film or couldn't think of anybody else.
There's another interesting collaborative element that has to do with acting, and I can tell you, for example, that Stefan was telling me that he was working with an actor whose name I won't mention, and I query Stefan about how it was to work with this actor, because, you know, you're under such pressure, and especially in an independent film where time is of the essence, you just don't have a lot of time.
Time actually is money.
Time is beyond money, and you don't want to work with assholes. I mean, that's basically the reality, because they will cost you time, and they will cost you aggravation and anguish. And it often comes out of, you know, just ego and perverseness and you know, dysfunction. And so I check out the actors. You know, you might say, here's a great actor, and he's interested. And then I say to Stefan, okay, Stefan, what is he like to work with? And Stefan says, he's a fucking nightmare.
That's about the gist of it.
And he explains to me why. And the thing is, you see, that someone who, because Stephan doesn't just do special effects makeup, he does straight makeup, as we say, normal makeup as well, beauty makeup and whatever. He could do all that stuff, and he has done that on my films as well and other films. Who knows the actor intimately? Well, the costume person and the makeup person and the hair person, they know. And they also know whether it stays in the trailer. You know, if someone is giving Stephan trouble in the trailer, but when he comes to the set, he's great, and he doesn't come to the set late, then I say, okay, I'll let Stephan, he'll absorb the anguish, and I don't have to.
Yeah, I'm going to be the mattress in the morning. It's just like it's pummeled.
Does that happen a lot?
You know what? Sometimes, because they're the first person they see in the morning, so you have to be like their shrink and so on. So whatever happened to them that morning, if they didn't get their coffee or the traffic was lousy, they're late, then you're kind of like, okay, here we go. We're going to be walking on eggs this morning.
Yeah. You know? And for me, you know, that's okay because it's part of the process. But I think it's sort of character building. Look at this man. He's in good shape. But
you know what I say? It's kind of like you can always make it look like an accident. You know?
Jeremy, were you going to say something?
No, I just said some actors, you know, it's like in life, are too charming. And other actors, one actor particularly, who again should be nameless, he manages every day to make the makeup artist his driver, the makeup artist, the costumier, and the hairdresser cry before he got to the set. I mean, he was he needed to do that to be absolutely beastly to these people to get ready to work. You know, that was.
And I accept that. But what I don't accept is if he makes me cry. and then you do check them out to see what damage does this actor do on the set. You know, how much time will he cost? Will he destroy the other performances in order to enhance his own? I mean, there are all kinds of strange things that can happen. I have to say I've had mostly terrific relationships with my actors, and they've been wonderful. But part of the reason for that is that I do check them out, and I avoid the ones who are going to be, you know, they're going to be a nightmare.
Actually, that's a nice way of coming back to Crash. You know, particularly a lot of the makeup effects are, you know, compromising sometimes for, you know, for people who trade on their looks, you know, and they're, you know, they're particularly poised in their walk. You know, Rosanna Arquette in the movie is in braces and has, you know, huge scars and slits where she's wearing mini skirts. You know, James Spader is looking beat up for a lot of the movie. Holly Hunter is, you know, showing her body in ways that, you know, she aren't exactly erotic. How much?
Wait a minute. I thought they were a little erotic.
They're very erotic in parts of the film, but you know, wouldn't be traditionally for how she would present herself to other films potentially. Was there a lot of anxiety around that? And did you work with work with them to sort of understand the process?
No, Crash was such an extreme project, such an extreme script, that the actors who could not deal with that were gone immediately. I mean, they wouldn't get past page 4. You know, that was it. They were finished. And so you knew that if an actor said, I want to do this, that actor was going to go all the way with it. Because it was like an on and off switch, you know. There was no middle ground. You know, there's just no middle ground. And a lot of the projects that I've done are like that, actually. An actress, very famous Oscar-winning actress, who I approached for a role in Maps of the Stars, and there was one scene. She really wanted to do it, but there was one scene she kept coming back to. She could not deal with this one scene. And I felt, you know, that's it. You know, that's going to be a problem that's going to grow, and it's going to poison the whole role. And I ended up with Julianne Moore, who had no problems with any of the scenes, and she's also just fantastic. So,
not a bad substitute there.
No. I mean, I was, you know, my mantra is sometimes the right person says no. You know, it's not always the right person says yes.
That's what I meant about after the film starts and you've got the film finished. when you look at the film, you can't think of another actor to be.
Yeah, if it works, you say, boy, I can't imagine, who else was offered that role before this person, and you could, because they make it their own, and they're brilliant, and suddenly they are that role, and there's no other possibility. That's when it works.
Great. And so, just Stephan, going back to Crash for 1 second, how was the relationship with the actors as you were beating them up
Crash
for makeup
worlds? That movie, makeup-wise, for me, was like, I call it the movie about designer wounds. And every single actor was so cooperative on that movie. There was no, because very often you will get, they'll accept the role, and they know that they have to be, you know, mangled and so on and have scars, and then they'll try to slip in. It's like, can you make it a little bit less here, a little bit less that, and they try to eliminate that. Well, that's not what the script says, and that's not what David wants, but I'm sorry. That's the way it is. But on Crash, they actually were asking, like, can you put a little bit more? And Holly was like, make this a little bit angrier and stuff. They were really into it, which was great. You know, there was no reluctance at all. And Arquette's body armor, as I called it, that thing, it's an art piece by itself, because we actually went to a company outside of Toronto that makes prosthetics, and we bought all the equipment, and we made our own out of the material that they actually use. So it's the real thing.
That's in the exhibit here too. It's been recreated, and it's fantastic looking.
I think it's actually one of her original outfits, actually. Yeah.
Somebody told me it was a reproduction, so I don't know what the truth is. You'll have
to. No one will ever
know. I can't just believe you. That would be...
We have one more clip that I wanted to just throw out there, and then we'll have a quick discussion and start taking some questions. Can you roll the Dangerous Method clip, please? So, Jeremy and David, on the surface, Dangerous Method feels like something that must be much easier to put together rather than something like Crash or Naked Lunch. Period costumes, noble figures from history. Although, you know, some sexual content as well, that's maybe not, you know, to every financier's taste. What was it like putting this together?
They're all difficult to make films that are sort of profound and sort of with some sort of serious side, even though as an entertainment. And the world of cinema has changed a lot in a film like this, although it has been very, very popular everywhere in the world. Floating it in, a film about Freud and Jung, and... immediately, people think, well, that's an intellectual film. It's going to be limited in the people who want to see it. So that was a problem going forward. By now, after Naked Lunch was different to today with David. David is, he's got this show. He's the most celebrated director in Canada. And that brings a certain reality to my job, because I have got something much better in my hands to promote. You know, so I've got some... a star in itself. David is himself in the movies, like one of the movie stars. He's not as difficult, of course, but he's like one of the movie stars. And they help you get the stars to be in the movie. We got an incredible cast for that film with Kira, who came immediately, and Fassbender, and Viggo, who became later. I mean, that was a very, very powerful deck of cards for a producer to play with. And using the sort of the treaties and various ways, places where a producer can find resources, and David agreeing to shoot interiors in a studio in Germany, we managed to find the budget. And it was quite an extravagant film, because you know it's very luscious, it's a period film, it's got carriages and castles and locations and lakes and various other things which are difficult to make period films around. So that's where the inherent problems with that. But I don't think this was one of the most difficult ones we did. I think this was a shorter time to set it up than the actual setup time. I think we managed to do it in a couple of years. It wasn't like an 8-year one. This was a couple of years.
And Stephan, it's funny, we were talking before, and I was saying, like, well, maybe this doesn't show your craft in quite the same way as those two previous clips, but actually we were talking backstage, you said there are a lot of subtle subtle aspects to this movie that people might not even know are there, but actually contribute enormously to the film.
Oh, absolutely. You know, people are used to see the things like The Fly, and there's like very, you know, flamboyant like monsters and creatures and things like that. But on a movie like this one, I absolutely loved it, because that's one of the things I love in makeup is when you reproduce like historical characters. In this case, it was like Jung, and more so Freud, which was Viggo Mortensen, who came in a little bit later in the picture. And it was nice to, well, this was the third time working with Viggo. And he came in, and David suggested it, and I agreed totally. Maybe we could do something with his nose. He has kind of like this little Norwegian upturned nose, and Freud had like this more like Austrian Jewish nose, more like mine. And so I did this. We did like, I did three prosthetic. The first one was bigger. It looked a little bit too much like a cross between, I can't remember the name of the actor, but he has like a nose like this, that didn't work. So I just like streamlined it, and it was gelatin, and it went on and blended in very, very well, and added a little bit of piece of a beard over here to make it fuller. And Viggo has blue eyes, so we put brown contact lenses on him, and I added eyebrow pieces, lace pieces, because Viggo's eyebrows are very, very light. And Sigmund Freud's eyebrows were like darker. So that completed the look, of course, with the costume and everything.
I have to tell you, this is an incredible worry for a director to have prosthetics on an actor's face. You're doing a lot of close-ups, and sometimes they're in the daylight, which is, you know, you can't hide any of that with the lighting by backlighting it or whatever. And really, what Stefan did in Dangerous Method was truly brilliant, I gotta say. I mean, and Viggo was, for the actor too, to have confidence that the nose will move with his face in a real way, that when he comes out and talks to you in daylight, Viggo was delighted that no one realized that he was wearing this nose. They thought he looked a little different, you know, but they didn't know why. And that is so hard to do. And it's hard, really, not all makeup people can do this kind of thing. It's incredibly subtle and requires real finesse because you're constantly shooting close-ups of this actor. And I remember when I saw Lawrence of Arabia, and not being a movie maker at the time, I remember the two flaws in it were Anthony Quinn's Arabic nose, which didn't move and looked like it was made out of concrete, and the hairline and Jack, what's his name, one of the other actors. Jack Hawkins, his hairline looked false. And this is a huge production with, you know, 1,000 camels and, you know, trains and God knows what. But you get close-ups of these actors, and you really notice the flaws in their makeup. I know that Stefan could have done a much better job.
As a matter of fact, talking about Lawrence of Arabia, just on the side story, I remember talking to the son of the makeup artist who did the makeup on Lawrence of Arabia, and the director kept insisting on having put more mascara on Peter O'Toole to make him, his blue eyes pop out and his dyed blonde hair to make him look really different from the rest of the Arabs. And finally, the makeup man said, if I put more mascara on Peter, you're going to have to change the title to Florence of Arabia.
That's great. I think we're going to maybe bring up the lights and actually start to begin a conversation with you guys. So if there's anyone out there who's interested in asking a question, we do have mics. So if you could just hold on till someone brings you one. There's a bunch of hands up, so let me know when you've got the mic. All right, I think you're going to start us off there.
Okay. So this one's for you, David. My first question is regarding... Sorry.
I'm over here.
My first question is actually regarding Crash, and just the way that the crashes are staged. I mean, obviously the actors are very much into the sexual aspect of it, but in terms of trying to film it, I mean, what was your protocol for trying to make something not alluring? Or is that a practical thing, or is that something you discuss in the editing room, or is it both?
I'm not sure I can actually remember what went on then, but the crashes were very difficult. I mean, I can tell you, once again, not storyboarded, but discussions of how we might, you know, shoot it and do take two and take three for different angles and so on. And I can tell you that when the Porsche actually crashes, hits the Ford, it's a remote controlled car at that point. And it was 4 o'clock in the morning, and we were trying to shoot the scene, the crash before dawn came, and the remote control guys were operating it like, with a little remote control, like you'd operate a little tiny car, except it's this full-size Porsche replica. Of course, those cars are incredibly expensive, the few that exist now. And suddenly, I hear a crash. We're not shooting. And they had run it up a bank, and then it fell over. And it cracked the very handmade plexiglass windscreen. And they thought I was going to kill them. But actually, I was so exhausted at that point, I just laughed. I just laughed. They still tell me, thank you for not killing us. But we, you know, so it took a lot of time to put that car back together again and fake a new plexiglass shield and so on before the dawn came up and so on. And I mean, that's just one incident, but it gives you an idea of the detail that goes into a crash, like to staging something like that. And the other crash, I mean, you need stunt people to drive cars who really, you know, are good. I mean, this is the other thing. One of our stunt people was wearing a wig and was looking like James Spader, and we were shooting him from the back, and he's really throwing this big Lincoln Continental convertible around, something that Spader absolutely, he was willing to try it, but, you know, you want your act. If the car crashes, that's one thing. If your actor is under it, that's another thing. So there are all kinds, I mean, I can go on forever about that sort of thing, but you do have people to help you. Once again, that is part of the collaborative thing. You have a stunt coordinator, for example, a fight scene in the sauna, the Turkish bath in Eastern Promises. You know, the stunt coordinator worked with the actors for weeks. And I would go and see, you know, we talk about what space we would use in the sauna and how I wanted it to move from one space to another. And we then design the Turkish bath to have those spaces that we built it. And then when the actors had time off, they would, from shooting, they would work with the stunt coordinator. And they'd call me in and they'd show me stuff. And I'd say, yeah, but I think it'd be more interesting if we do this. And I need a little more here and a little less there. So that by the time we got to shoot the sequence, once again, not storyboarded. But basically, it's like, as I say, found art at that point. A lot of prep has gone into it. But then at that point, it's like I'm trying to figure out how to shoot a documentary of what we've now done. They can run the piece like a piece of theater, and I have to figure out how to shoot it. And it's only then that I really can figure out how to shoot it. I can't do it in my head beforehand, because the reality of the space, of the actors' bodies, of the light that we come up with, all of that, none of that do you have when you're doing storyboarding. And to me, that all factors into how I want to shoot the scene. It would be the same for a crash, a car crash. You know, really no different, in a weird way, no different from choreographing a scene between two people in a room like Freud and Jung. You know, there's choreography that goes on there. Which I work out with the actors first, and only then do I start to think about the lighting and how I will shoot it. First, it's like a little piece of theater. I'm not sure I answered your question.
It was fascinating, though. Over there, where the
Hi.
Blue light is. Yeah.
Hi. I definitely remember a model that you had of the Gardner. I think the Gardner State Thruway. And I believe, I just wanted to ask you, was it handy to help or have that model, I believe, when you were designing the look and the shots and the visuals of Crash, and how that helped, or if it did, and in what way? Thank you.
Well, you know, these days, you would get a pre-visualization. You would get somebody who was spending, you know, really a lot of money, sometimes $500,000 if it's a big film, like, let's say, Total Recall, where a group of people, computer animators, will actually do the movie for you. I mean, with movement and everything, it's beyond storyboards. At that point, it's a computer graphic. It's like a video game version of the scene or the movie. And then, you know, I find that quite weird, I have to say. But in those days, when we were making, you know, and still actually, for me, Carol Spear, production designer, will sometimes make a model of a room, let's say, or the Gardner Expressway or whatever. And actually, there's a little, it's almost like a stethoscope. It's a little microscope that you can look down into it and walk through this little miniature version of what you're going to have with little cutouts for the people. I mean, it seems very crude these days compared with the computer graphics thing. But it's a lot cheaper, and it's a lot less sort of constraining because there's no sort of studio expectations. I mean, with Total Recall, for example, I saw previses done with the and they even had the leading actor in the previs. This is a huge action sequence with explosions and guns and sci-fi, you know, vistas and stuff. But the actor looked like Eric Bana because at the time he was the one who was going to play the lead, and now it was Colin Farrell. So I thought it was pretty weird. I hope Colin Farrell didn't see the previs that had the actor who bailed out before he got the gig. But little weird things like that. But the Sony chairman of Sony actually was from the Japanese home office of Sony, said the movie's going to be fantastic. I've seen the previs, you know, and if you're the director, and suddenly you hear that, and you're really the pressure on you to just shoot the previs, but with the real people and the real sets would be enormous. It would be huge. It would be quite weird. And no there, fun. There you would have collaborators who were CGI animation artists. I've never worked with that, and I have to believe that in this case, I think it was done before there was a director on the shoot. So I have no idea who was directing the previous. But once the director comes, you know, it can get quite weird. I know we're quite far away from Carol Spear's models, but. But for me, the model thing works well enough that I get an idea of what the space will be like and what kind of lenses I might want to use and what the colors look like in the set and so on and so on. So that's a sort of a crude and old-fashioned version of previs.
Stephan, are you confronted with that much when you sort of walk into a production and they've already done have like a chunk of work that you have to sort of respond to?
That doesn't happen to me very often in my field. That's... I remember using storyboards, or you know, I did storyboards when I started out, and I did a little bit of storyboarding for David, some sequence, Existence, for instance. But no, that doesn't really affect me.
Next one. I'm pointing right there. You got the mic.
Hi. Go. The three of you guys actually keep mentioning storyboards and your lack of use of them. And I'm a film student at Ryerson. One of the things that they keep talking about is how essential storyboards are for when you like go on set and so that you're prepared and you know exactly what you're doing and you do it and you have that preparation. So what, I guess, is that process for you, like when you're actually on set, when you don't have like a visual shot-by-shot representation, or if you sort of form it on set, or like how does that work?
Well, here,
I mean, I didn't say I didn't use storyboard myself, and I'm every director works in a different way, really. Some directors really want to have the storyboard to help themselves make the film, and they storyboard every cut. Every single cut is storyboarded by a director, and I'm working with a director right now who comes from visual effects supervision, and he wants to storyboard the entire movie and has done. And so that, I've never worked with that before. And then other directors want to only storyboard the scenes that the people around them need the information. A lot of people need the information for the technical work. But I wouldn't say that anybody is exactly the same in the way they use a storyboard and what the storyboarding means, because it can be a very basic little sketch to be one of these sort of previs, which I've never used myself, that David mentioned.
Yeah, I mean, the truth is there are an infinite number of ways you can be a director, and you will invent your own. You have to inevitably invent your own version of it. That's what I tell anybody who comes to observe on my set. The way that I do it is not like the way. It's just the way I do it and the way I've developed it. But you can see the limitations of storyboards in terms of the acting. For example, amongst my collaborators are my actors. They're my colleagues. They're my comrades in arms. They're not like the enemy or anything like that. They contribute a lot. And though I don't want them to improvise the dialogue because, you know, it's improvising dialogue, if you set up your whole movie to be that, like John Cassavetes used to do, then that's one thing. But it's very rare to set up a film like that. So I think it's pressure that an actor doesn't need to actually invent the dialogue, especially if you have good dialogue already. But what they do is their movement through a scene, the choreography, like a ballet, like a dance, that I really want the actor's input there. Where they turn to say the line, where they turn away, turn their back to the camera. How do you storyboard that? You don't have your actors to work with when you're doing the storyboards. And therefore, you cut out the collaboration of the actor if you really insist on doing the storyboards exactly the same way. Because, for example, I go on the set, I don't know, we've cast the movie, so we've got the actors, we've got the cameraman, we've got the set, we've got the costumes, we've got the props. But I don't know how I'm going to do the scene. I have all these things to play with, but I don't know how I'm going to do the scene. And I clear everybody off the set, except me and the actors, and then we work out the scene. And for example, if I say, I think it would be great if you are standing at the window and then you turn away when a certain line comes and then you turn back. And the actor says, what if I'm like on the couch? What if I'm lying on the couch and say this? And then I say, that's a great idea, but the storyboards have you at the window. You know, that's the problem, is you get so locked into the storyboards that there's no room for spontaneity, invention, inspiration. And I do know from talking to my crew members that there are certain directors who are almost not even looking at the monitor as the scene is being done. They're riffling through their pack of storyboards, you know? It's just like, okay, let's now storyboard 2, storyboard 3, storyboard 4. And then if you do that, you can squeeze the life or the spontaneity out of the scene. So to me, for me to storyboard, it would be like a security blanket. It would be a fallback position that I would take rather than the way that I like to do it. So when I walk on the set, I don't know what I'm going to do. But of course, on a certain level, I'm very prepared because of the script, because of the, you know, working with the actors, even working with the actors and developing the costumes with the costume person. Costumes are incredibly important for actors. I've done a little bit of acting myself, and although you're standing about 10 feet away from where you would be as a director, it's a totally different universe that you're in, because nobody cares what the director looks like, although Bertolucci did have wonderful hats, I have to say, and scarf. But you know, you could have a cold sore, you could be unshaven, you could be, you know, have no sleep. Nobody cares. But if you're the actor, your body is your instrument. I mean, that's what you got to work with. I mean, the voice as well. And so, the actor brings a huge amount to the life of the scene, and also the interaction amongst the actors. And how do you anticipate that if you haven't even cast the movie when you're doing the storyboards? You see that? I know that it's done. I have no desire to do it. A big special effect sequence where there's a lot of technical stuff, yeah, I understand that.
Next one. Right here, in the front.
Well, first I'd like to say I really like your perspective on storyboards. I think I'm going to tell my teachers that now.
Uh-oh, revolution. She's going to tell her teachers not to do storyboarding.
They always make us do storyboarding.
Well, but, you know, I can understand it in a classroom situation, to see if your student has some sense of cutting, of visual, you know, composition and stuff. I mean, as a teaching tool and a collaboration with your teacher, I can see that. I absolutely can see that. But to say that there's a, I have to say, a lot of teachers themselves have a huge mythology in their head about what it is to be a filmmaker. And sometimes they're not filmmakers themselves, and sometimes they are. And they often buy the Hitchcock mythology, you know, that you do it yourself in your head with, you know, you maybe have a storyboard artist helping you sketch if you can't draw, and that's it, you know. But anyway, continue.
So mine is a very general question. I'm just wondering, as a seasoned director, what would you say is the biggest learning curve for young filmmakers looking to enter into the industry?
Great question.
Yeah. Well, I, you know, times are very different now from when I started. The cameras are, you know, everybody could, you could literally make a movie on your iPhone, and you could even edit it on it. That kind of stuff wasn't around when I started. But of course it depends. I mean, some directors come, for example, come from theater, and they're very good with dialogue and actors, but they have no visual sense. In that case, you lean on your cameraman. You know, I think you have to. The collaborative aspect of it is huge, because I don't know if there's a director who really can do absolutely everything. Has a great ear for music, a great ear for eye for lighting, a great understanding of acting and dialogue, a great understanding of cutting. You know, there's so many aspects to it, or costume. You know, maybe you're just, I mean, look at what I'm wearing. You know, I mean, it's like, it's so you depend on your costume designer to bring things to you that are right for the character, because maybe that's one thing you don't have a good sense of. So, but to, first of all, so you have to understand how to work with your collaborators and allow them to help you. At the same time, to not muscle you into things that you don't want to be muscled into. That's tricky. But the other thing is, it's a very interesting thing. The first thing that was problematical for me was space. How to cut space into cubes. It was like cubism. I didn't quite know how to move the actors through space and relate that to the camera and to the dialogue and to the movement and the rhythm of the dialogue. It seems like an abstract thing, but it wasn't. It was a real, it was a difficult thing. And after I saw the first day's rushes, you know, I had made a couple of underground films myself, and I shot them myself, and I edited them, I did everything. And I must say, they looked pretty good. But then I'm suddenly working with a cameraman who has his own visual sense. I'm working with a professional crew, most of whom I didn't really know what they did, actually, at that point. And I didn't know how to use them to get the visuals that I had been able to get on my own, shooting my own stuff. That was part of it. And the other part is, the stuff that I shot didn't have any dialogue for various reasons. It was all voiceover. Now there's dialogue, there's close-ups, there's dialogue close-ups. And there's a rhythm to that. And even, honestly, the size of a person's head in the close-up, which you don't even think about when you're watching a movie. But it's a huge, you know, it's a really interesting question about, it's really a matter of composition. And composition, the thing that you're shooting more than anything else is the human body, either full or medium or close up, you know, that's what you're shooting. And it's coming to terms with that and movement through space. It's, even though most movies are 2D and not 3D, there's still, of course, a three-dimensionality to the space that you're playing with. So that, it's a lot, I think.
And I think, unfortunately, we've run out of time. So I'd like to thank our panelists. It was great. I think this could have gone on for hours. Jeremy Thomas, Stephan Dupuis, and David Cronenberg.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.